Welcome, everyone, to this episode of your Freedom Hub's Free Market Cash Patient. I'm your host, Jeff Cantor, along with Charles Frohman. We are being sponsored by the Marketplace for Health, Wealth, and Freedom.com. And we'll take a look at that in a minute. We are the disruptors intersection. One of the key things we are wanting to expose is the fact that there are some problems in the healthcare world, and that's the purpose of this webinar series. And we're going to certainly point that out yet again tonight. One of the ways we help make things happen is by making use of a delivery system as a special app that allows you to find and pay for doctors using cash. And we've got some special stuff set up for you to find that. And we do want you to visit the website because, as I said, everything is being recorded over there. So that being the case, let's take a quick gander. And this will give you a flavor of what we're talking about. So when you come to the marketplace and you hover over home, you'll notice there's a webinar tab. And that's going to be pertinent to what we're doing here tonight as an example. So we'll have a chance to see the 4 o'clock, the one right now at 7, our Thursday financial event, list of future guests, and the links to watch all these preceding episodes. So it's a good example. Here we are up on BitChute, over here on Rumble. So we're on all the key places. And then also we do want you to be aware of the fact that when you're hovering over here, the very important is the continuing the conversation tab. And the reason being is because after you have such a great talk tonight, you might want to follow up with that person after the fact. And so we have a follow-up process for everybody that we've had that's spoken with us before. So you'll really appreciate that quite a bit. Now, as I did indicate, we do have some other things going on. So we are having a number of organizations that are trying to help maintain freedom when it comes to your healthcare. And this is just a smattering of some of these types of organizations and also some key issues you need to react to. And it's not like one or the other. They basically all need to be dealt with. And then we definitely are not quite sure what's going to be forthcoming. So we're trying to be ahead of the curve. And in our special marketplace, we've got cards for you to be able to deal with vaccines or masks. If any mandates or things start to come our way, we have tools for you to be able to prepare yourself. So on that note, let's steer into today. So here's where I'm going to shift gears and let Charles jump in here and give us an introduction on today's guest.
Thank you, Jeff, and welcome, Joan. It's my privilege to introduce Dr. Tekula, whom I met a few years ago on LinkedIn. I guess for some reason we connected. I gather I looked at her profile and saw an expertise in oxidative stress. And given that Jeff and I, as the Forbes featured cash patient makers, were opening the market, we like to have guests on this webinar that teach us something that we didn't know before. And we keep hearing about oxidative stress and its importance in longevity. And in our conversation, I learned she was a podiatrist, and I've had some foot joint issues myself over the years, so she gave me some advice with that. I'm not sure, Joan, if you remember, with bunions and all.
Perhaps, yep.
But
I give so much free advice, I don't remember. I can't get back at all.
Well, maybe you can talk about podiatry some point tonight. But I discovered she really lacked a good healthcare solution for her own situation, and she has become a member of our cash patients revolution. And she got so into it that she joined our app world, where we are recruiting the doctors across the country who want more cash patients, because that is the key to happiness and fixing the market. So we want all of our team members to present at some point on this webinar. And in discussing that with Joan, we discovered that she is the longevity expert around oxidative stress. And in preparing this webinar, doing some research, I noticed that I learned that one of our earliest myths from the Sumerians, you know, around 2000 BC, the tale of Gilgamesh is about trying to live forever. And if you look at the anti-aging reports, everyone is fixated on living a long life and doing so healthfully. So that's what tonight's topic is about. How do you make our 30 trillion cells healthy so we can live a long, healthy life? So that's our intro, Jeff.
Let's find out how we're going to be able to do that. So, Joan, I am officially handing the reins over to you.
Perfect. Okay. Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm really honored to have been invited to share my story and some information that is near and dear to my heart. I'm trying to find my screen. Here we go. So yes, I've borrowed Charles's title. I love it, the fixation on living longer and healthier. And it's all about cellular level aging and how to combat it. Just a little background on myself, as both Jeff and Charles mentioned, I am a podiatric physician and have been for 32 years. I'm going to hit my timer, so I make sure I don't talk for too long. I love what I do. I didn't like the practice of medicine, the business of medicine. I saw the writing on the wall very early on in terms of being a physician and having my hands tied unreasonably by the powers that be, and that had nothing whatsoever to do with, you know, it had nothing to do with patient care, quality patient care. They all seemed to be arbitrary rules imposed on me, and I didn't get into medicine to be micromanaged. So I was fortunate to have become a contracted physician for the state in which I live, and I work in a psychiatric hospital for an hourly rate. I am free to do what I want for people who appreciate it, and I've been very, very happy practicing the way I have for the last 21 years. I won't take any insurance, and as Charles alluded to, as I'm an independent, I've had to pay increasing premium with increasing deductibles for many, many years. And when I learned through Charles about the cash pay option, or rather the cost sharing option, I quickly jumped on board and I've never looked back. So yes, I'm really passionate about medicine. I'm passionate about alternatives and prevention, and I am passionate about fixing a broken healthcare system. But this brings me to my freedom that I experienced because of my one day a week working at the hospital. Freed me up to express some of my entrepreneurial interests. And I had a passion for the seniors as well. I used to own a company where I provided assistive technologies for seniors to age in their home. I owned an anti-aging spa, which was kind of fun. And then what happened was I was beefing up my LinkedIn profile and was invited to become a tech scout for a company that commercializes inventions. I'm just telling you how it is I came upon this incredible technology. So what they wanted me to do, they had the wherewithal to actually take a product from discovery to market in terms of you know, the leadership and the marketing and the revenue. But I had the expertise to recognize what would be disruptive. So I spent several years perusing the university and government lab websites to see what was being discovered. I had a slant toward the biotechs, and I was looking for something that was non-invasive, non-pharmaceutical, and that was really going to change lives. But that path is very long and expensive, and most importantly, risky. And I was fortunate to have been introduced to a technology that was actually already being marketed. And that began my journey into understanding why we age, how we age, and what can be done about it. So we all hear about aging. Well, what exactly is aging? Well, at a cellular level, it's a very specific set of occurrences. I will say that there's over 37 trillion cells in the body, and that a cell is basically defined as the smallest structural and functional unit of the body. And if you have a healthy cell, you essentially have a healthy body. But likewise, if you have an unhealthy cell, since the cell makes up the tissue, which makes up the organ, which makes up the organ system and the person, then it's very unlikely that you will be able to maintain your health. And I always see the body as just a healing machine. When you understand how the body works and the complexity of it, and how, you know, the body can rob from Peter to pay Paul and maintain homeostasis at all times, you recognize that it's not so much why we get sick. I'm sorry, where we got sick or where we got it from genetically, but really it's how we stayed healthy. The body is all about recognizing, addressing, and fixing problems before there are problems. But again, if the cell is diseased, elderly damaged in some way, then it can't perform its function and do exactly that. So what we have here is a chart that most people are aware of, but you don't necessarily think about, which is that we don't expect young people to get sick. It's definitely a rarity. So on the x-axis, you have the ages, and very rare to have illness during that time, but you see that there's a dramatic rise in diseases in the age population, like 50, 60, 70. I see there's a drop off there, but I suspect that's because, I don't know why, perhaps they've died. But anyway, there's a significance to that, and we just kind of take that for granted, but what is the reason for that? So there's a couple of terms I'd like to share. Oftentimes it's called, buzzwords, when you use words that the general population don't understand. So I want to just review a few of them. We all know what it is to be hijacked. It's when something is taken over, generally not in a positive way. And many people feel that they are being hijacked. They believe that they're physically, emotionally, or genetically predisposed to certain illnesses. I'm sure everybody knows somebody who says, I have cardiac disease, but my dad did, and my mom did, and his dad did. And they believe that that's their fate. And lo and behold, they follow the same lifestyle patterns that their parents did. And that gene is expressed. And so it's justified as just part of their genetic, makeup. There's a new understanding about that. It's called epigenetics. And it says that we have every ability to impact the genetic expression through lifestyle. So biohacking is actually taking control of one's own biology. I can't move this thing, so I can't read my own slide. And optimizing your health. And it can be done in numerous different ways, adequate sleep, exercise, but very specifically, the buzzword nutrigenomics has to do with using plants and plant products to have that impact. So, I'll tell you just one little more thing, a little bit more about myself. As a child, I was 4 years old in 1965, and I had a sister who was diagnosed as diabetic. So growing up in New York City, she had the finest physicians, the pioneers in diabetology. And I had a front row seat to the idea that what you ate impacted your body. And I also, seeing how sick she was and what she had to go through, I kind of took a vow of health. I was not going to do sick, and I've lived up to that. That being said, biohacking, I consider myself a pioneer of biohacking. And now we're going to understand a little bit more about why we have control and that we have control. Even this is in January of 2019, Time Magazine had an article about why your DNA is not your destiny. I believe that's when epigenetics began to be a thing. And epigenetics, very specifically or structurally, are these proteins that are on either end of the DNA strand that used to be considered junk protein. Later to understand that they had everything to do with the expression of the genes within. So that being said, if you were genetically predisposed to certain disease processes, these junk proteins could actually, suppress that expression. Here we have nutrigenomics, the study of how nutrition and naturally occurring compounds affect our genes. So there are three proteins that activate our genetics, setting off a cell signaling pathway. Let me explain what that is. Basically, the proteins, when they're activated, they begin a pathway. It's kind of like, I'll show you my next slide, but big illustration. We've all seen these dominoes. So these proteins are essentially the finger on the first of those dominoes. And when you knock over that first domino, a series of occurrences, biochemical occurrences, occur within the cell. And ultimately, it results in some major outcome. So the proteins about which I'm going to speak today are NRF2, one's called NRF1, and then there's NAD. And they're all compounds, and they're all found within the cell. The beauty of these are that the cell signaling pathway, the end result of these proteins being activated, is that they result in very important cell protective functions. So the first one, NRF2, that protein activates a cell signaling pathway that results in the production of antioxidants. Most of us have heard of antioxidants. People think of blueberries or green tea. An antioxidant is just a compound that will sequester a free radical, and we'll go into that in a moment. So that basically protects the cell and is one of the primary theories of the aging of that cell, is when the superoxides or the free radicals are not checked, they do a lot of damage to the cell, and therefore the cell becomes damaged and vulnerable. The NRF1 protein has an impact on the mitochondria. I don't know if you all remember from high school biology, the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. So when we are young, our mitochondria are fully energized and intact. And as we age, they become damaged and less in number. And that system that was intact to replace them and to repair them has slowed down. So now we have a reduction in energy. And then NAD is another compound that I'll go into a little bit, but it has to do with many functions throughout the cell. And again, it's a molecule that is reduced in number as we age. So basically these are three systems of the body that are very active when we're young, and then they slow down. And when they slow down, we cease to have the protection from the antioxidants. We cease to have a replenishment of the mitochondria, which power the function of the cell and of the person. And we cease to replenish NAD. And that's probably the newest of the discoveries and the most widely researched at this time. I'll go into that in a little bit. So there was a doctor back in his graduate days in the 1960s at Duke University, who, his name was Dr. Joe McCord. He actually discovered something in all the cells of every organism that lived in the presence of oxygen. Didn't need to utilize oxygen, but if it was present where oxygen was, so in other words, if it was not an anaerobe, something that is killed by oxygen, then it contains something called SOD. And SOD is superoxide dismutase. SOD is one of our antioxidants that we create. And this discovery opened up the whole idea of free radicals in the body. So we knew about free radicals. It's what, you know, tarnishes silver or, you know, I don't know, browns an apple or any kind of an oxidative process. But we didn't know that we had oxidation and free radical damage going on within the body. So for this discovery, because it was so huge, he received something called the Elliott Cresson Award. That was given to all major contributors to any kind of scientific discovery. So like the Wright brothers and Alexander Graham Bell and Tesla and Madame Curie, a wide variety. But this discovery is in very good company. It was profoundly important to understand that we were subject to the damaging impact of that free radical process, the oxidative process. So getting back to that switch number one, the NRF2, free radicals are basically primarily created by the body. And it's during the process of making energy, which is a problem because we make energy all day long, around the clock. We need it. Without it, we're dead. So it's sad that in the process of creating something critical to life, we create something that is so damaging. But add to that, there have become environmental factors that bombard us with far more free radicals than we are in a natural, more natural setting. And as you can see, it's ionizing radiation, even UV light, smoking, and all the air pollution and nastiness that our poor bodies are subjected to on a regular basis. And as I said, since this happens at the cellular level, and the cell is the building block of us, it has a wide spread impact. If you do indeed have damaged cells because of this free radical damage, it's going to affect every system in the body. You know, because you'd say otherwise, come on, how could it cover all of these areas? Well, it covers them all because they're all made up of cells. In fact, the nervous system, anything related to the nervous system is the most directly impacted because the nervous system is the round the clock, never ending metabolic system, I guess, that creates the most free radicals. And it's also very sensitive. So if you wonder if oxidative stress is indeed a medical problem, there are over 241,000 studies on PubMed.gov. So for those of you who don't know, the National Institute on Health, your tax dollars pay for this online reservoir of scientific research. All the articles, all the research that has been published here has been peer reviewed. And 241,475 studies having been done were done because of the widespread impact of oxidative stress. So it's everything from cardiovascular disease to autoimmune conditions to cognitive dysfunction to, you know, just any chronic illness, diabetes. And I had mentioned the NRF2 protein. Once it was discovered that there was this system that had created, and I didn't mention, aside from SOD as an antioxidant, our bodies also create catalase and something called glutathione. All three of those are created when NRF2 is activated. Well, glutathione is a really potent detoxifying agent, and it is the second most abundant compound in the body after water. And it's critical. Unfortunately, it is a large molecule and very difficult to get into the cells. They're working repeatedly, relentlessly on finding ways to get it inside the cell. The liposomal, if you take it orally, there's infusions. But when it's made within the cell itself, there's nothing better than that. It's an absolutely perfect system. So there are currently made this slide a couple of days ago. So at that time, there were 16,981 studies, again, on the various ways that NRF2 can be used to address diseases, I guess. So getting back to oxidative stress, it is known to be the underlying cause of over 200 chronic illnesses. And again, when we're young and that system is intact, the cell is intact, so we're fighting off whatever. As that slows down and it's not there to protect us, we are vulnerable to all of these. Well, the reason there is so much research on it is that it's a huge focus, I guess, for the pharmaceutical industry, which is looking to create drugs, chemicals, that will recreate and actually activate this NRF2 system so that it will address their particular disease process. So the American, and there are also, non-pharmaceutical associations that were interested, the American Heart Association, various universities like LSU studied NRF2 for, malignant melanoma. National Institute on Aging did a study, and talk about longevity. It was proven that activating efficiently this NRF2 system increased the lifespan of male mice by about 7%. So it's really has a lot to do with health and longevity. And again, if you were to ask, 1,000 people if they want to live to be 120, most of them would, no, not so much. Because the image of someone at 120 is just completely dependent and feeble, and it's not a pretty picture. But if you could live to that age and be independent and have your health, I think that most of us would want that. There was, all these articles were written and read by the Washington State University, and their conclusion after reading, somewhere upwards of 100 studies, said that NRF2 may well become the most extraordinary therapeutic and most extraordinary preventative breakthrough in the history of medicine. So it's really exciting, and it's remarkable to me that nobody knows about it. I mean, I didn't know about it till I learned about it, right? But it's the most of the medical community don't know about it, and it's a shame, but the pharmaceutical industry does. Tecfidera was the first drug made from it, using the mechanism of action of activating the NRF2 system. It is the top selling drug for Biogen. It's also the top selling multiple sclerosis drug, and it is a very dangerous drug with lots and lots of side effects. It's really, really expensive, but that's how it functions. It actually was tested against some natural products that can activate the NRF2 system, and some of them that shall remain nameless for today were actually proven to be more effective. So the switch number two has to do with that second system and theory of aging that I had mentioned in the beginning. And again, we call them a switch, or I call it a technology, because this is not about supplementation. You don't take mitochondria by mouth. You don't take antioxidants by mouth with any kind of an effect that's worth mentioning. You don't take NAD by mouth. The best way, because the body is so perfect, is to turn on that system that was active when we were young. and let it determine the precise amount. And my favorite analogy for this is, again, my sister having been a diabetic, this is near and dear to my heart, but a type 1 diabetic has a non-functioning pancreas. So the supplement is wonderful that, you know, one can take insulin from an exogenous source and more or less control their blood sugars, or at least stay alive, but it's very imperfect. So they have highs and lows, and that's where all the sequela, all the complications of diabetes come from. Whereas if you could take something that reactivated the pancreas, then you've got perfection, because the body really is perfect. So when I say switch, it's about a technology that actually turns back on the body's perfect system. So the second theory of aging has to do with the mitochondria. Again, as the cells split, as we get older, the mitochondria are less than perfect. And they, ironically, so the mitochondria are what make the energy. They create a molecule of, or numerous, I don't even know how many, 12 or so, molecules of ATP for a single molecule of glucose. So if you ever wonder why you have to eat to keep your energy and to keep up your strength, it's because it all gets converted to glucose, which gets taken up in the mitochondria, well, outside of the mitochondria first, but ultimately in the mitochondria, and it goes through a process called the Krebs cycle, and ATP is formed. And ATP is the raw form of energy. You cleave off a phosphorus and you have ADP and the energy that goes with that. And I'm sure this is way too detailed for most people, but others of us love this stuff, so I thought I'd throw it in there. But each time the cell divides, so in the process of making that ATP, we make these superoxides. It's a highly reactive form of oxygen, and it bounces around the cell, and it doesn't damage just the other organelles within the cell, it damages the mitochondria. So mitochondria creates these superoxides, which in turn damage it. And again, when we're young, we replace these and repair them. But as we age and that NRF1 pathway slows down, we end up with some really dysfunctional mitochondria. And the obvious end result of that is a reduction in energy physically, like noticeably. Like I get up in the morning, I'm not me. Never don't have energy. But the average person says, you know, I'm sluggish. I don't have the energy I used to have. You know, I'm glad I had kids when I was 20 because I couldn't do it today. That is the obvious end result of that. But more than that, almost more important for health, is that these mitochondria create the energy to fuel the functioning of the cell. So if you have a reduction in the energy within the cell, everything is becoming sluggish and impaired. That's the second theory of aging. And here's the one I'd mentioned was more or less, it's currently being studied extensively at both Harvard and MIT. Harvard, I think it's Dr. David Sinclair, who wrote a book on, what the heck did he call it? I don't recall, but I think he started using the word health span, which is the combination of lifespan done healthy. I could be wrong, so don't quote me on that. But he's at Harvard and he is an anti-aging scientist. And then there's an anti-aging scientist at MIT named Leonard Guarente. And I believe at some point they worked together, but anyway, the discovery was that when they were able to increase NAD levels, the mice that they were experimenting on across the board lived longer than their littermates that were not NAD activated. And NAD is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide. It is an essential cofactor in many functions throughout the cell. I mean, absolutely critical. Like for instance, what's called autophagy. I call it autophagy, but I understand it's autophagy, which is kind of like the cleaning out of cellular debris. So stuff is, you know, just like any other metabolic process results in waste. If you don't get that waste out of the cell, you've got a clogged and unhealthy cell. It's an essential cofactor in the metabolism of energy, that Krebs cycle that I was talking about. But the discovery that they made was that it activates the sirtuins. There are 7 sirtuin proteins. And the one in particular they were studying was the one that is located in the nucleus and has the job of protecting and repairing the DNA molecule, as well as controlling the genetic expression. So you have the same, we all know that we can be cloned, right? Every cell in the body has the genetic information for the entire person. But there's a liver cell, which doesn't perform the same as a hair cell. It doesn't perform the same as an eye, whatever, retina cell. And that's because there is a suppression of all those, that genetic material that is irrelevant to that function. But as we age, the NAD levels are known to drop down. They get used up and not replenished as that system slows down. And we now have impairment of all these different systems, all these different functions. And when the sirtuins are not supported, they leave their watch and the cell begins to lose its, differentiation. So it's been differentiated as such, but now it loses that. So the way that the scientists were able to stimulate the NAD pathway was through metabolic restriction, significant metabolic restriction. So you had these thin mice that were living forever, completely disease-free, not something I want to do. And then a whole bunch of their littermates that they allowed to become obese that not only didn't live very long, but they developed all kinds of disease processes. So this is truly an important, really critical compound that needs to be replenished. And replenishing it, like I mentioned earlier, as a supplement is never going to be as effective as stimulating that pathway that will indeed increase your NAD levels to the extent that you need them, because the body is perfect. And so we're working on different ways to activate that system, other than getting down to like 500 calories a day, because that's just not living. So that's basically what I have to share here. If you'd like to learn more about these systems of the aging cell and a solution, I would love to hear from you. My email address is Dr. Joan Michelle. It's a new one. It is not misspelled. My mother had a great sense of humor, thought Tekula wasn't bad enough. So it's Dr. JoanMichel@gmail.com. And my telephone number, I welcome a text at any time, 203-264-6664. Just identify yourself and your reason for reaching out. And I think that's all I've got.
Very good. Well, I appreciate that. It was an awful lot of great information there for sure. So I'm definitely eager for some people to throw out some questions. And right out of the gate, I see Charles has one for you.
Excellent.
Great presentation, Joan. Thanks, Jeff. And seeing some, I took some notes here about, this is a great chemistry class. Thank you.
But it wasn't too detailed.
No, it was perfect. And, you know, we need to learn this stuff because there are lots of different experts and leaders in, you know, epigenetics, trying to get us to, you know, help our bodies do their job, which I gather is sort of your theme here. And I guess people argue about how to refire the perfection of our cells and, you know, figure out how do we slow this clogging and disease down. From your experience with different interventions, drugs, and supplements, what are some of the better solutions you've seen out there among your doctor cohorts and scientist friends? Can you name a few, best sellers that people seem to be looking towards to find those solutions? Does that make sense, that question?
Yeah, it does. Like I said, there are some drugs, mostly the NRF2 is the one that has received the most attention because of the discovery so early and the knowledge about free radical damage, and also because it's the primary reason for aging physiologically at the cellular level. That being said, there are natural products that stimulate this to a small extent, something like broccoli seeds. I forget what it was called. Something chlorophane. I apologize. I can't remember exactly what it is. But it's,
chlorophyll?
No. It's I know it, like I've said it 20 times and I can't think of it right now. Dr. Campbell, do you know what it is? Broccoli seeds. Anyway, there are some natural products. There's some are more effective. Ask to unmute. There's some that are more effective than others. I actually represent a product line that has a huge impact, but I'd rather not, if it's okay, share that at this point. The FDA is very careful, and we are very careful to be respectful of the difference between a drug and a natural product. And drugs can make claims, but I have spoken about disease, so I'm really not comfortable sharing the product itself. But you know, like I said, caloric restriction would work very well toward increasing NAD levels to a small extent. So people, that's one of the benefits of intermittent fasting, is that during that period, whether it be 16 or 18 hours, there is actually somewhat of an increase in the NAD levels. So it's hugely important. Oh, I can't believe I can't. Sulforaphane. That's what it's called. Sulforaphane is the active ingredient in broccoli seeds. I think there's turmeric might have a mild impact on NRF2. But there's combinations of these that are just that much more impactful. And I have no idea how one might increase. Oh, I think exercise. Exercise can have an impact on your NRF1 pathway. And it's for obvious reasons, right? That if you believe in God or if you don't believe in God, however the body was designed, it responds to the environmental challenges. So if you exercise a lot, then there is an increased need for energy. And so the body rises to the occasion and it does increase the health and number of those mitochondria. So I'd say that those would be three very basic ways to address those three deficiencies by allowing the body to do its thing.
Excellent.
If I could follow up, unless there's someone else with a hand up.
Go ahead. We do have a hand up, but go ahead quickly. Slip.
How do you define exercise in a way where you get that environmental response? And then can you comment a bit more on intermittent fasting, how you do that correctly? Those two things.
Sure. I think really any exercise, but I think it would be dose dependent. So I am a passionate and very competitive, very competitive in my own mind on my Peloton and CrossFit and weightlifting and all that. So when I spend, you know, an hour to 90 minutes in a full on sweat, you know, heart rate anywhere between 150 and 170 for that time, I imagine I have quite a bit more mitochondrial biogenesis than somebody who walks. But I'd say that, you know, just moving. And I think that's part of why they say that sitting is the new smoking, is that when you just are sedentary, you don't have a need for energy. And so there's no stimulus for it. So I would just say any level of exercise would be an improvement over sitting, and then moving from there. And by sitting, I mean, like, I own a treadmill desk. So I don't even sit generally when I'm working. I walk even just 2 miles an hour, pathetic as that is, just to move, or I'll sit on a ball so that I have to stabilize my core. I think sitting is just death. And intermittent fasting is the best way to do it, is to choose a 6 hour window, 6 or 8 hour window during which to eat. And it has to be, you know, it's personalized, right? It, for me, I never eat at night anyway. I'm just not interested. So I like to finish eating by 6 p.m. And then you go as long as you can that next day. So as long as there's a prolonged period where you haven't eaten anything at all, you can have your coffee, but no milk in it. And then you want to stop your fast with something protein. I'm almost certain it's a protein is the break in the fast. So I might eat until 6 and then don't eat overnight, get up in the morning, have a black coffee, work out, take a shower, maybe noon or so, have a, you know, a couple of eggs and vegetables. And other than that, you eat more or less whatever you'd like during that time. It's less about dieting and more about giving your body that break from digesting and that.
Very good. Dr. Campbell, I see you have your hand up.
Yes, hi. Dr. Tekula, what a wonderful talk. I don't know, Charles and Jeff just find these brilliant minds and get them to us. And I'm becoming a little addicted to this series.
Let's quote that, Jeff.
appreciate that compliment.
Well, I'm an anesthesiologist and I've done chronic pain management. And I've seen, you know, in chronic pain situations, I've seen diseased bodies turn into diseased minds. And I've seen, you know, people who just can no longer function. And then I see people like you who obviously have energy and seem to be ageless. I feel like we're on the cusp of you know, really understanding it. But it may be the next generation or two before we really get there. But I value all your, I've taken notes and I took a couple screenshots. I value everything that you're giving me here. I will tell you that a great attending of mine, Dr. Harry Oakham, wrote a book called Boom. And he really talks about, you know, the things that seem to work, the intermittent fasting. And he says also that towards the end of that, you do high intensity interval exercise and then do your protein.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
It's really, you know, one of those super food.
We can't hear you, Dr. Campbell.
You started to break up, yeah.
Oh, I was going to say turmeric is really shown to do a lot of good. So I just think we're on the brink, and I really value people like you who kind of put these things together and look through 2,000 PubMed articles. So thanks. And as soon as you figure out the magic pill, I'll take it.
Well, then you know what? Then text me because I might just have that for you.
Okay, I will do that.
Please do. I'd love to hear from you.
Very good. Charles, I see you were popping your hand again there.
Well, I want to put Jim Graypek on the spot. If you want to unmute him.
Keep going.
How could you hold him back?
Because, Jim is trying to create a market of Epcot's around the country and probably the world that facilitates that next generation of self-healing and integrated therapies. So, Jim, how do you respond to what Dr. Tekula has presented, and how does that fit in your pavilion image?
Before I get there, I was raising my hand like really, because it disappeared from my screen. I mean, my, raise hand icon is gone. Just letting you know. I don't know why. All of us want to age well and live long and be happy and all that good stuff, free, of course. I was going to ask about, there's a lot of things. I mean, as Dr. Tekula brought up, if you can really eat well, you have your broccoli, you have some of the, NAD and other supplements that are out there, you're getting the right exercise, your sleep cycle, your EMFs are neutralized, your environment is clean, and that's what the pavilion is. In fact, I was going to say, that's what this pavilion, this project I'm working on, and we have our team, is because a lot of these things also are difficult for a single person to do. I mean, I know you're the same thing as, I forgot this supplement today, or, you're doing all your things, and every day it's kind of, I need a support team. You know what I'm saying? We all do our thing, but you get tied up, the phone rings, your kids, whatever it is. It's kind of, we need that community around us with the right support to keep us going or fill in the cracks or something. What I did want to say is to add to that, since you've been looking at this specifically in anti-aging and living well, where do you see telomerase and, research in that area going? And because, probably, right, if they could just take care of that, then there's nothing else we have to worry about. Well, right. Being healthy, you might live a long time, but you can't walk,
Right.
I know, as the cells don't, they keep regenerating. But have you looked into that at all or done anything with that?
Well, I think you certainly, I certainly know what they are. I don't know the research going on, but I do know that it is, unfortunately, we are mortal. And there is a real reason, as that DNA is being read, it has to sit somewhere and each one will be shortened. There can be lifestyle shortening of it, which means you have a unreasonably short life, but I don't know that there is a way to extend life by extending the telomeres. I think it's a consequence of living that they...
My understanding and some of the people in the military intelligence community and stuff is that There, I mean, it will be out shortly. But I don't know who will have access to this. There are, I forgot. I mean, but there are some organisms out there that don't their telomeres don't shorten. They're always reproducing, and certain organs and things. So we are, I mean, that's some of the work that's going on.
I didn't know about that.
Yeah, but that would be cool.
And that means we live longer and healthier, or just longer?
That's just longer. It could be like forever, literally, but you have to still keep yourself healthy.
Right, because that's the whole thing, is that, you know, just because your telomeres don't shorten doesn't change the quality of life.
Yeah, if you're still, you know, going through a bottle of scotch every few days, right, it could be a problem.
And you'll live forever. Isn't that a preservative?
At least you'll be pickled. Right.
You'll be pickled, yeah, exactly. Yeah, I'm sorry, Jim. I don't know enough about that, but I love your mission. I'd love to know more about what you're doing.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
I'm all in favor of it.
Yeah, the goal of the series is definitely to create some synergies, too. It's not just all these independent thinkers, but how do we get some of these things to merge together? So that's really quite good. So that's excellent. Well, I'm going to say we're reaching near the end here, Dr. Tekula. So if you want to kind of give us a little conclusion or wrap up, put a little bow on this for us here.
I guess the conclusion I would want to share is that, you know, it seems like everybody on the phone here and on the call here understands this and practices this anyway. But what I like to tell people and share in a general sense is that we are not out of control of our lives. We are responsible for our health, not just in our actions, but in our thoughts. As Dr. Campbell mentioned, there are people, you know, psychosomatic illness is real. It's a real illness, but it comes from the brain. And there are many chronic illnesses like that I think are personality disorders. I won't be naming any in case somebody here has one. I don't want to be insulting in any way, but again, they're still real illnesses, but we can make a decision to be healthy. Just believe you're healthy and do everything you can to allow your body to be the healing machine that it is. And that is, give it the basic and see that that's what you're doing. Not just following, you know, what you're told you should do, get good sleep and eat. Why? Because then your body has what it needs to do what it's designed to do, which is protect you from organisms, all kinds of invasion and any dysfunction within the body so that you live a long and healthy life. So I'm proud to be a part of, my philosophy has been, I don't do sick since I was four, as I shared, and my practice is like that. And I raised my children that way. And now I'm honored to be a part of a company that promotes some products that actually help you to execute that belief and to live a longer, healthy life. And we'll see. I'll be 60 on Monday. I feel about 30. I'll let you know. We'll talk again in the years to come. But my plan is to live independently until I'm, I don't know, 90 or so, and then just get tired.
That way it'll just be your 30th anniversary of being 30. So there you go. You'll leave it at
there. There you go. I like
Charles, that. Would you like to add a closing comment for today?
Well, this has been great, and it fits right with our mission. We're trying to empower patients as shoppers of what's out there in the health market, and part of that is taking care of yourself. So why not present our members with the best leaders like Joan on how to do that, how to take care of yourself and be healthy and live the life you deserve and use that perfect human body that you have to its full advantage. So this has been fantastic.
Excellent summation. Joan, thanks so much for today.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to share, and thank you all for attending.